Good afternoon. I'm very pleased to introduce you David Orban. David is an adjunct professor of the LUISS Business School, and he's also a fellow and a professor within the Singularity University. Singularity University is a very interesting initiative that David will explain to you very soon. He has a very diversified experience, being an entrepreneur, being the chief developing officer, something like that, of one of the company that is quite interesting, chief innovation officer and a member of the board of directors of .sub. .sub is a company that is developing some interesting applications in the, let's say, digital world. David is a I would say an expert. He's a renowned speaker in a topic which is quite special and interesting for us, at least in our understanding, which is the explanation of the singularity, or the explanation of the exponential effect of the new technologies and change in the society and in the technological domains. So, since I've been discussing with David about the possibility of trying to expose you to what is going on around, if you remind, we in our first lecture we tried to discuss the big challenges that there are coming in different parts of the society, of the economic system at large, on the political environment, on the sociological environment. So we have a lot of changes. David is an expert in explaining what is going on outside of the normal business environment and try to understand it, what could be the future effects of these changes in the big mega trends. This is more or less what I asked him to explain. He's also one of the active members of this network society, or I don't remember exactly the exact name, but he's an expert in understanding the role of networks in the society. And he's also a very fascinating speaker, but also writer in this area. So I don't want to steal more time. I leave the floor to David that will introduce himself in a more precise way, and at the same time will try to give you an idea on what does it mean exploring the singularity, what does it mean exploring the exponential effect of the new technologies and changes in the society. David, thank you.
Thank you very much. None of that is true. When people start calling you an expert, you start dying. It is a den. But thanks anyway. I define myself a professional outsider. Every 4 or 5 years, I change industry. I without asking permission, without having a license, without having any authorization, I just say, oh, that looks cool, and I go there and then do stuff. And if other people appreciate what I do, then it creates waves, things happen, right? So the way that things happen changes, of course, in time. Thousands of years ago, the radius of what you could do, typically, was around your village, or maybe a few dozens of kilometers or miles around your village. There is a reason for the fables to talk about the seventh son going away and having incredible adventures, slaying the dragon and marrying the princess. Is because they died. And then they became protagonists of fables and they were having fantastic adventures. Because when you left your village, you died. First of all, because it wasn't allowed. You were a vassal. You were not a slave. You were not property. but you were not free to leave during feudal times the area of your feudal lord. So when you left, anybody could kill you. But also bandits, or just simply because you couldn't find food, you died. But you left the village because you died if you stayed in the village too. I don't think it was a lot of fun. It is easier now. And you are here because you feel the opportunity of taking advantage of the freedoms that we have evolved from hundreds or thousands of years ago to today, and the radius of the opportunity that you have encompasses the entire planet. When you speak up, there are literally billions of people who are ready to listen. And you don't need any authorization, any license, any permission to start speaking your mind and to create very simply aggregating people who resonate with what you say, opportunities for yourself and for them. And you have to do it overcoming the natural resistance that you feel because you've been told from when you were born that you have to listen to authority, that you have to wait until you are ready, that you are punished when you make a mistake, that is all really wrong. Because if you were punished if you make a mistake, you would never learn to walk. If you had to wait until you were ready, only Nobel Prize winners would go and cook a dinner. We all naturally learn by making mistakes, and other people totally understand that. So as soon as you start speaking, and by speaking I mean blogging or Facebooking or whatever it is on WhatsApp, it doesn't really matter. As soon as you start spreading your message, other people who are at your same exact level will say, yeah, I understand what she's saying. I am really trying to find the right questions in the same field. I have no idea what the answers are. I don't even know what the questions are. But I am exploring together. So basically that's what I do. And it is a lot of fun. I don't know if it happens to you that your mother asks you, but what are you doing anyway, or what's your plan, or how is it going to fold out? And you know, I'm 50 years old, and I tell my mother I have no idea. I think it is okay. And obviously, not everybody should be pushed to do like that for many reasons. So I'm not saying what I do is something that you should necessarily emulate. I'm just giving you some testimony and an example, and then you can either like it or not like it. But you are here for a couple of hours with me now, so you have to listen. You have no choice. There is an important hypocrisy of today's world, and I think it is good that we speak about it right away. It used to be that when you became an adult, society gave you certain signals that recognized that stature, and then it was a one-way street. You know, that stature and your position in society were recognized, and then you built on that in a certain way. And it didn't matter whether you were, a farmer, a factory worker, or the head of an industry, or a politician, or a king. It didn't matter. Your role was kind of set. How many of you had one or both parents that worked 20 or more years in the same job? Practically everybody, right? How many of you expect to work 20 or more years in the same job? 10? 10 years or more? 10 years or more? Okay. 5 years or more?
Okay.
Right? So, in a generation, in a single generation, that was the reality, and we don't know what is going to happen in 5 years or 10 years or 20 years, but your expectations already have been completely changed. Almost none of you, maybe one, thinks that he or she will work in the same job for 20 years or more. Probably she's inheriting a family business. And she deludes herself that this is not going to die. But most of you realize that the dynamic of today's economy is such that you have to start with the expectation that change will be the norm, right? Whether you change the job, or whether you change the things you do, whether you have to learn skills that not only you don't have today, those skills you have to learn don't even exist. So it is impossible to teach them. Okay? You are in a school that is inherently, unavoidably incapable of teaching you the things that you need to do and to learn. Okay?
Thank you.
Sorry.
I invited you, so I...
I know. I know. And it's not the school's fault. You know, every school on the planet is in the same situation. Schools have to reinvent their roles, what and how they teach and why they teach it, and they have to establish a new type of dialogue with the various stakeholders, you know? For example, when I came here before, this is my first lesson as an adjunct professor. I've never held any academic position, so this is new for me, you know? Like, a professional outsider, I'm having fun hacking the system, okay? So the first thing I asked, is the class open? Because people, I said, hey, I'm coming to Rome, and people said, I want to come. So I asked them, is the class open? And the answer I got is, no, we are sorry, the class is not open. And I don't know whether that is a standard answer, or they ran it by you and you confirmed, doesn't matter. Because I'm recording anyway, and I've got to put it online. And then either somebody will listen or nobody will listen, and I don't care. It's not even a matter of whether somebody will listen in a week, in a month, in a year, because we don't know why what we are thinking about and creating and putting out is going to matter, you know? The number of unknowns that we are facing are really amazing. I do like to get in touch with people. You know, I am perfectly available on every kind of platform. So please feel free to seek me out on Twitter, on Facebook, on LinkedIn, whatever else. It turns out that I have to go with what are the constraints and the type of conversations that happen on the platforms, right? So Twitter has its own language, and LinkedIn has its own ways of doing things. Facebook happens to have a 5,000 connection limit. I'm very close to that limit. So you are welcome to friend me, and I will look at your feed. And I have set explicit criteria for accepting or not accepting connections on Facebook. I publish those criteria, so you will see them on my feed. And it is interesting because you cannot fake it, you know? If you don't correspond to those criteria, I will not accept the connection. You will become just a follower. But you cannot go back and say, oh, I will have to change my feed from 3 months ago in order to correspond to that criteria, right? I am having fun with hacking those things as well. But anyway, whether it is email or Skype, you're welcome to... I haven't published it, but I have a public calendar where you can just book me. You can book me for a conversation, and then either it's going to be Skype or Google Hangout, or we can have a coffee. For example, I tweeted yesterday that... that I was in Rome, and somebody said, can we have lunch? And so we had lunch, and he's here to attend the lesson because it turns out he was an alumnus of LUISS, right? So this is also part of how you build serendipitous, unexpected connections because people matter, right? We can do a lot of things with automated systems. So for example, LinkedIn tells you, I think you should connect to those people, or Facebook says, aren't you or shouldn't you be friends with these other people? That's all great, that's all fine. Machines are starting to learn to know us better and better, but people-to-people connections are still extremely important. With the various organizations that I'm involved in, either having founded them or designed them or led them, we look at many, many themes that are around the world today. And I have 180 slides to go through, even if I'm doing these long introductions and asides that I have just started. So I will either go quickly or just stop at a point and say, okay, I will come back in a few months and finish. And I also want to dedicate time to have a dialogue with you. So I will try to speak for maybe another half an hour, and then we really open for questions and a conversation. But one of my messages is really that a lot of the things that happen in the world today, you cannot plan for them. It is not a question of insufficient data. It is really mathematically impossible to plan for them. I have a video on YouTube entitled Exponential Uncertainty. After class, you can check it out if you are curious, that explains the mathematical reason for this. So here is this thing. Who knows what this is? Who knows what this is? Louder, please.
Google.
Yes. It's the second generation Google car that doesn't even have a steering wheel anymore. You just call it with your smartphone. If you're around Mountain View, close to Singularity University's headquarters, at 10 in the morning, you can see them starting to leave their garages, and then in the evening they come back. They are still experimental, but more and more states in the U.S. are passing legislation to plan for their massive introduction. I addressed the Italian Parliament a few months ago, and after talking about AI and lots of things, including robotic cars, it turns out that the head of the Transport Commission's working group was there, a senator, somebody, I don't remember the name, and he says, you know, this is really amazing. We are just closing the works for reforming the traffic laws, and this doesn't happen very often, every 10, 20 years maybe, or even more rare, and we haven't thought of including robotic cars. So Italy runs the risk of being stuck with legislation for the next 10 or 20 years that has no idea what is going on in the real world. But what relationship does the robotic car have with 3D printing of human organs? Any idea? The first cause of death for people in your age bracket between 20 and 30 years is car accidents. And they are very convenient because you are young bodies from whom good organs can be explanted and put into old people. That is what happens. That's the only source of human organs we have. Old people want young organs. And when robotic cars are going to be widespread, young people will simply stop dying. The major cause of death of young people will be eliminated. But old people will still want human organs. So there is an entire industry being born so that by the time robotic cars are introduced, a new source of human organs will be found because young people dead are not going to be available anymore. Okay?
So it prevents from accidents as well.
Say that again?
Car prevents from accidents as well. It's robotic car.
Well, we don't have a lot of data yet. We have a few hundred cars having driven themselves for about 3 million kilometers in 2 years in California, and there were a total of about a dozen accidents. Okay, none of these were caused by the robotic cars. All of these accidents involved a robotic car and a human-driven car, and the cause of the accident was the human driver in the other car. So it is expected that robotic cars will, for all practical purposes, eliminate accidents, and not only human death. There are about a million humans that die every year in car accidents. And about 50 million humans are permanently damaged. They are disabled in one way or another, causing incalculable suffering, but also extremely high impact economic damage. And society will radically change, as well as all the car companies will die. Because today, cars are the second most important investment of any family after the house, and they are the only economic investment where if the rate of utilization exceeds 10%, you start bitching about it. Oh my God, I've been driving for 2 hours and I still have to drive. 90% of the time the car is there doing nothing, correlated to its purpose, which is of transporting people. And that's the way we want them. It's totally wrong. Robotic cars will never stay still. As soon as they deliver you where you want to go, they say goodbye, and they will go someplace else to do something else. As a consequence, we either reduce the number of cars on the road 90%, or we dramatically increase the number of trips that we take. So for example, in many societies, mothers bring children to school, then they take children and they bring them to a tennis lesson, then they take the children and bring them to study with the friends, then they bring them to home. And I, for sure, with my grandchildren, because my children are grown up already, but with my grandchildren, I will feel so safe having a robotic car picking them up from school, delivering them wherever, and then finally home, whenever. And the balance will be, according to widespread analysis, a reduction of about 70% of the number of cars. So in an economic paradigm that is currently dominating, where car companies are trying to grow larger and larger and larger, this gale force of dramatic dematerialization is coming and hitting them unstoppably. And the more they try to be big, the worse it is going to be. General Motors went bankrupt already once. And there's no way they will be bailed out again by the US government as they have been in 2008. And FCA can you name a car company that will survive?
Or after the robotic cars?
Correct. Google, Apple, and Tesla. Those will be the car companies of the future. All of the others are going to be dead.
Yeah, but I think, sorry to interrupt.
No, please.
These cars, as far as I understand, they won't have one owner. So it will take a person to somewhere, then it will go to other places, and they will be pretty much the same for the first 10 or 20 years. The developers won't work that much on the design, on other complexities. And with the cars we have now, we feel the owner. So there is one thing you feel, you have a good Mercedes car, it's part of yourself. So you don't want to let that car go. It's part of your family, for males especially, I think.
Absolutely. You're totally right. and race cars and Ferraris, yeah, and all those kinds of things. Yeah, they will be available in reserves, like going to see a lion or a giraffe. You will go and drive your car in a protected racetrack where you will be allowed to let out your male testosterone, but you will not be allowed to kill people on the roads.
It's kind of safe exit, this one.
You know, today we feel that we are wasting time when we are in the cars because we can do nothing else. But in the future, there will be a lot of things. I, for example, when I am in line, I seldom go to the post office. But when I go to the post office, there's always a line. And it takes me probably half an hour to whatever I want to do. It doesn't matter. And it used to be that I would be upset. But today, I'm not upset. I'm just there, either reading or working or having fun, watching the movie, doing whatever I want in the queue at the post office for those 30 minutes. And the same thing wherever I am, right? So in the car, there will be a lot of things that are going to be happening. People will be working, having fun, anybody and everybody. Also, there are...
Your queue, because you don't use Urami.
Yeah. Urami.
I don't know what it is.
It's a startup that avoids queues.
Oh, okay.
It's been adopted by Royal Mail, but was considered not good enough for the Italian post office.
And it's started up in LUISS Labs. It's accelerated, yeah.
Congratulations.
Well, I'm not sure that... but they are selling a lot of services, also in Spain, I think.
Anyway, yes.
One key point I would like to underline one message here. I mean, we are thinking about the future society as it will, let's say, evolve in our way of thinking. However, a lot of, let's say, teens, young people are changing their mindset, and they will project themselves in the future in a different way. So I grew up thinking that reaching the possibility to buy a Mercedes and having a BMW or Mercedes for myself is a great achievement, right? But I'm not sure that the future young adults will think the same. Maybe they will have other aspirations.
Yes.
About what my friend said, but what about the pleasure of driving?
Yeah.
Even if I'm in a traffic jam, I like to drive. Pleasure.
And you will pay for that. You will pay for that privilege, literally, and that will be fine. It is a market decision, right? You will still not be allowed to kill people. So, in order for that privilege to be enjoyed, you will have to be in an environment where you cannot, even if you try, you cannot kill anybody.
So driving becomes a game. So if you go to the theater to see a movie, and you go
that's
to
right. It will become an entertainment an entertainment option. Yes.
Okay.
I think that it could be possible, maybe also to make like a you are doing it yourself, but there is also something automatic, so you can avoid incidents at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
So if you are doing an incident, so the car stops you and drive it by yourself.
It is very interesting because, of course, you can project an end scenario where all the cars are robotic and only the exceptions are human-driven, and those are segregated and in a racetrack. But actually, it is going to be progressively introduced. So already, self-driving options, the auto-drive option, is available on Tesla. And there, it is the contrary. So it is the human driver that is supervising the machine and intervenes when the machine makes a mistake. So you have to pay attention. Then the next step will be what you are saying, that most of the time, the human won't need to be doing anything, and when the human does something, the machine will correct the mistakes that the human would do, and then only after that completely self-driving cars will be common, where actually the human doesn't need to have a driver's license, because all the legislation in place today requires that the self-driving car has on board a human with a driver's license. Yes?
All of the biggest automotive company has the driverless system since a lot of years. The problem, I mean, in Italy, is the government. I explain better. These cars are electric. And, okay, driverless as well. But this is a problem. This will be a problem about the insurance, because insurance company controlled by the state wants to block, to stop this kind of car. And government don't want electric cars for the taxes of petrol. So in Italy we have a lot of restrictions for these technologies, because for this reason,
I understand what you are saying.
Needs taxes.
Sure.
For the petrol, for the insurance, for the a lot of things.
Yeah, I understand. So, now, what you are saying is correct, and it is true for every country. Every country can decide.
We have already this technology since a lot of years.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So whether we do or we don't, and how long, you know, computing power was not really available at a sufficient compact rate. There are supercomputers that are doing this, and now supercomputers are these are supercomputers, right? So even if on a theoretical level these solutions were available, in a practical level they couldn't be implemented.
Yeah.
Because every self-driving car would cost tens of millions of dollars, and it would do, you know, 1 meter an hour, because the computing required is so huge and the sensors would be so expensive that it couldn't do anything more. So theoretically it was possible, practically it became possible, but those companies that knew that this was coming lost a lot of time, and they don't have any time anymore. And it doesn't matter if the state wants to hold the population back.
Yeah.
The population of the state that holds them back will rebel, will say, no, I don't want to live in a state that doesn't understand the future.
I know.
Either I will leave, or I will change things, right? So in a closed world, it is easy to keep things back. But in an open world, it is very easy to look just left or right and say, oh, that's worse, I don't want to emulate that. That's better, I will copy from them, right? So obviously, in Italy, I don't know how many you are aware, but there are two types of electrons. There are the electrons that you burn in your lights, and they are relatively cheap. I mean, they are four times more expensive than they should be, but still. And there are electrons that you put in your car. And the electrons that you put in your car are 10 times more expensive, because they need to include this absurd tax that cannot be obviously controlled. And as a consequence, in Italy, you are not allowed not to be connected to the national grid. To be off-grid in Italy is illegal. And then Italy is debating to actually put taxes on your electric bill, for example, the television tax, okay? Because you become an extremely well-controlled vassal, feudal vassal, totally enslaved to the state through these constraints. You cannot disconnect from the electric network. The electric network becomes the way of taxing you, and any type of tax can be put on your electric bill just with a signature from the state, right? So that is the point where the social contract breaks down. People say, well, I cannot respect that law. And people start disobeying the law. Do you know you are all criminals, by the way?
Yes.
Okay, I know why. And I don't know whether my example is the same as your example. Let's not incriminate ourselves more than we should, especially because I'm recording this. So let me say why I think you are all criminals, okay? Because copyright infringement has been criminalized. It used to be a civil issue. If you infringed somebody's copyright, they needed to sue you, and they needed to demonstrate that you made what you... that you did what you, they accused you of doing, and then there were fines. Today, the United States of America has been able to sell its own legislation around the world, and that legislation has been adopted almost everywhere, making copyright infringement a criminal act. Okay? So you can go to jail for copying a song. All right? But every one of you have devices in your pockets whose job is to copy bits. You literally cannot browse the web or do anything on the internet without copying. That is, you know, when your browser shows you an image, it makes a copy of an image. And it doesn't matter that it is not practical to prosecute you, it is enough that you are blackmailable, that the controls that are being set out to verify what you do, what are your browsing habits, are stricter and stricter. And what is tragic about it is that the original reason for this was the Hollywood business model, okay? Which itself was born through intellectual property infringement. You know why Hollywood is where it is? No, it's not only because of the weather. It's because it was far enough from New York, where Edison's lawyers stopped anybody from shooting movies unless they paid him patent royalties, because Edison had all the patents covering the movie industry. So the rebels and the criminals that created Hollywood were far enough 120 years ago in California so that the lawyers couldn't reach them. And that is why the movie industry has been born where it was. And whether it was the movie industry or broadcast radio or cable television or the VCR, these technological inventions were all uniformly and universally based on breaking the business model of the existing incumbent industries, because they allowed songs to be played without an orchestra, because they allowed television to be seen in the skyscrapers of New York that couldn't receive it with a regular free-to-air antenna, because they allowed time shifting with a VCR where you recorded a movie or you passed the movie to a friend on a cassette. And the existing industries sued the newcomers always, always, always up to the Supreme Court. And then regularly at the Supreme Court they lost. And the Supreme Court established the precedents that required that they agree on something. So universal licensing was born, where a DJ takes notes of the songs that he or she is playing, and then they are tallied up, and then the royalties flow to the creators of those songs at the end of the month or the year or whatever else. And none of the authors of the songs can go to a radio saying, hey, I heard you played my song a lot, it must be very popular. Rather than paying me this rate, you need to pay me 10 times that rate. There is universal compulsory licensing, and the rates are established regardless of whether you are a big star or a small star. And this is just an example with the radio, but the same changes happened and rippled through industry after industry under industry. until 10 years ago when the universe bifurcated. We are living in a wrong universe where the Supreme Court, in the case of Grokster, which was inspired by Napster, who knows what is Napster, okay, and Emu, and whatever else, right? So 10 years ago, all these new things were being born that leveraged the peer-to-peer nature of the internet, where computers are made to copy. And yes, you could have a million friends and you wanted to pass them the songs. And who was anybody to say that that was wrong? So Napster was sued by over 130 companies simultaneously. And they folded. They said, we cannot resist this. And they sold themselves to, ultimately, I think, Symantec. I don't remember to whom. Grokster said, no, this is the right fight we want to fight. And they went up until the Supreme Court. And they were totally sure that they would win. Just like the VCR won, and the cable television won, and the radio won, and forever. And they lost. The Supreme Court established that whatever they were doing was wrong. Not only that, but they established a new type of crime, contributory copyright infringement. So if I'm the maker of a gun in the United States, and somebody buys my gun and kills a third person with that gun, I'm not liable. That's perfectly fine. But if I make a piece of software and somebody uses that piece of software to infringe on a third person's copyright, then not only that copier is criminally liable, but I am criminally liable as well. Contributory criminal copyright infringement established by the Supreme Court of the United States, 2006 Grokster decision. So for the past 10 years, it was impossible to establish the new business models that should have been already in place to naturally exploit for our devices what they are good at doing, which is copying. And then whoever gains what value and how and what, we don't know, because it was stopped in its tracks. And the venture capital investment and the startups and the great businesses, everything that should have developed hasn't.
You were talking about the peer-to-peer systems, and I think the peer-to-peer system changed a lot of industries, like the music and other industries. I had a question for you. Do you think that the peer-to-peer thinking of the peer-to-peer as a peer-to-peer production, so could change the concept of leadership in the next years to create something like a bossless company? Thinking about a company that has no leader and that manage itself like an animal, like a biological animal, no?
Sure.
So a cellular.
Yeah.
Could be possible for you?
I will get back to your question and give you the answer, and the answer is yes. But in order for everybody else to understand how we get there and why, we have to take a step back. So when Napster folded and Grokster lost, peer-to-peer didn't obviously disappear. What was the protocol that was born? BitTorrent, yes. BitTorrent is the protocol that evolved out of the attempt to kill an idea, right? Ideas cannot be killed. When you try to repress an idea, it just evolves. That is why antibiotics are dangerous, because wrong uses of antibiotics are accelerating the evolutionary pressure on the bacteria that you wanted to extinguish, and they just become smarter in spreading their ideas, which are their genes. And in human societies, it's the same. So the new protocol BitTorrent is much smarter than Napster, which was centralized, because BitTorrent is decentralized. And not even the Chinese firewall can stop BitTorrent traffic that is able to go through anything and everything. Yes?
Two comments. One is just kind of real quickly that you touched earlier, and I just wanted to kind of get an understanding. I didn't know if it was facetiously or maybe it's something I don't understand, but you said there's two types of electrons, you know, one for electricity and one for gasoline.
Cars.
Mm-hmm. So was that just being in a facetious manner? Because as an atom, there's, of course, only one
sure.
type of electron.
So in the eyes of the legislator, the electrons that you put in your car should be taxed in order to generate the income they need to spend in things that they think are useful and 90% of the people think are wasteful, right? So yes, in Italy, physics is the same as in the rest of the universe. There's just one type of electron.
Okay.
Yes?
I was just making sure I was on the same page.
Yes.
And the second one was a comment on to peer-to-peer sharing. So, I mean, of course, you know, IRC and news file sharings and all these other things are continuous and still growing, and BitTorrent was actually existing before Napster. It was just not known until, you know, one gets repressed, another one steps in,
yeah.
and like Windows, another year, another model.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, there'll always be that file sharing protocol, and then when one becomes renowned and suppressed, another one will always take place, being open source or, you know, whatever the case may be.
Mm-hmm.
So I just wanted to see how you felt, you know, like with still the classic of, you know, IRC going on in the background, and you still have news groups going on, and BitTorrent is continuing to thrive,
right.
being the new Napster.
That's right. So as new things develop, the old does not disappear. Okay? It used to be that all of the planets were dead. None of the planets were alive. And most of the planets in the solar system are still dead, but Earth is alive in many, many ways. Not only in the ways that we are classically accustomed seeing, from certain points of view, even the rocks are alive because they have been fundamentally transformed by the processes that life generated on Earth, right? But if you look at them superficially, it's still, the Earth is still mostly dead. And life is just a thin layer on top. Animals are cool, and especially we think humans are cool. And animals are certainly doing a lot of things, and especially humans are doing a lot of things that simpler life forms cannot. But if you look at the biomass, the dominating life form on Earth are still single-celled organisms by, you know, how many. If you put together, they are 1,000 times more massive than not the multi-celled organisms. They've been around for 2 billion years. The multi-celled organisms have been around only for 400 million years. And terrestrial animals have been around, I don't know, for 100, let's say, I don't remember, and so on and so forth. So the new never totally replaces the old, but certainly the interesting developments are happening where the new things are. So what is a pity about this attempt to repress peer-to-peer protocols is that we are losing a lot of precious time to exploit their beauty, their fun, their interesting consequences in business, in entertainment, in emancipation of the individual, etc. And you know, it's going to happen. It is just going to be delayed. As I said, the universe will reconverge with the original track where Grokster didn't lose, and we will be a little bit behind, like a second race with a ghost car that precedes you because you are not good at driving on your simulator. So back to your question. We have BitTorrent that is fantastic in transmitting information. But at the birth of the internet that gave us a lot of interesting protocols, HTTP, FTP, SMTP, etc., there was something that the original architects of the internet were not either smart enough or courageous enough, or just the mathematics wasn't there to integrate and implement. And for the past 6 years only, we have it. Anybody knows what protocol is that and what is the mathematical invention that enabled that? And what is it that it transmits over the internet easily? It is the blockchain technology represented in the Bitcoin application transmitting economic value and trust, okay? Who is familiar with Bitcoin? Who have heard of Bitcoin? Okay. Who owns a fraction of Bitcoin, has a Bitcoin wallet? Okay. If we had more time, just a little bit more time, I would say you are not allowed to leave without having a bit of Bitcoin. Mm-hmm. And if you send me an email saying, hey, I am Jane or Joe from your class, I would like you to infect me with Bitcoin, I will send you a fraction of a Bitcoin, okay? And I've done these experiments a dozen times, and it is so depressing that nobody ever does it, but maybe 1 out of 100. So beat my expectations of you being so passive and lost to the future. Send me that email, ask for a fraction of Bitcoin to be infected by this revolutionary thing. Who reads The Economist? Okay. Do you remember a few weeks ago blockchain was on the cover of The Economist? Pay more attention. A great cover, it was entitled The Trust Machine. They are typically very good, and they were very good this time also, in getting to the core of things that many others superficially interpret for what really doesn't matter. So what is the value of Bitcoin and whether it goes up or down? Oh, Bitcoin is crashing again, or a Bitcoin exchange has gone bankrupt and somebody's been arrested and stuff like that. Well, turns out, who cares? The fundamental invention that is the blockchain is a revolution, is a total revolution that potentially can be bigger than the internet itself in its implications. Okay, because it used to be the case that we needed, as humans, when we didn't know each other, a third party to be able to trust each other. Okay, so when two tribes met in prehistoric times, either they had a common language of trade and they were able to barter salt against, boar legs, whatever was precious. Or if they couldn't find that common language that expressed the value exchange, they went and killed each other. Today, we are still living in a society that is organized with centralized and hierarchical structures, and we are required, we are forced to trust those centralized structures, and most of the time, they don't deserve our trust. So whether you want to travel and you have to ask for a passport and the state graciously concedes you to have a passport in order to be able and just move around, or whether you want to do business with somebody and you have to use a given medium of exchange, which is either a dollar or a euro or an Argentinian peso. And if Argentinians say, well, we'd rather not use the Argentinian peso, they're not allowed. They are not free not to use it. They are required to use it. And now, for the first time forever, it is possible to establish a common language of trust through the mathematical invention of the blockchain that is really going to change the way we organize our enterprises, our societies, and how we aggregate and deploy reputation. So an enterprise is going to be able to implement algorithms that we will call smart contracts to acquire raw materials or services, transform them with value added, and then deploy them or sell them. And these algorithms will automate what today we call middle management. Okay. I will go back to the role of top management. Okay. Do you realize that that the concept of employee shouldn't exist anymore? I have several companies, and I like to interview people I hire, and one of the most important messages to new hires from me is always make yourself dispensable. Do everything possible so that what you do is automated, because then, one, you know that you mastered it. Two, you grew to the next challenge. Three, somebody else will do it if you don't. And that is going to happen not only with blue collar, but white collar workers as well. And you don't want employees. Employees are those people who you tell what to do, and they just do it. No, those are computers, those are robots. We don't want to tell people what to do. People are much more precious than that, okay? So employees are gone. Middle management is going to be gone with smart contracts based on the blockchain. So the answer to your question is absolutely yes. Companies are going to be running themselves.
Even the top management?
Feel free. Okay. Yes.
I think you still have open source projects and companies, so not per se the managers are going away, but everyone contributes and it's still a viable, sustaining system.
Who heard of Holacracy? Holacracy. H-O-L-A. Holacracy. Raise your hand, be proud. He heard of Holacracy. The word is a little clunky. I don't even check why with an A instead of more natural sounding O, H-O-L-O, holacracy, whatever. Doesn't matter. It is a new type of management philosophy where self-organizing teams decide what they need to do rather than bosses telling underlings what to do. And the most recent and prominent example of implementing this type of management philosophy is Zappos. Who knows of, or have heard of Zappos? So Zappos is a company that Amazon acquired for about $1 billion. And they were originally born to do just like Amazon, but for shoes. Just for shoes. Amazon started with books. They started with shoes. And the guy who Tony Hsieh, who founded Zappos, is really a rebel as well. And so he moved the entire company to downtown Las Vegas, which was a very bad area of Las Vegas, and totally was reborn as a consequence. So when he implemented this new system in the company, and it's a large company, I think like 15,000 people, and he said, okay, in 3 months or 6 months, whatever it was, we are not going to have bosses. Nobody will be told what to do. Everybody have to self-organize in these groups and decide what to do. And he said, and by the way, if you don't feel that you are comfortable in with this new kind of organization, we are not going to fire you. You can consider leaving, because this is what we are going to do anyway. And if you choose to leave, we give you money to leave. We will give you an exit bonus. And 15% of the workforce took the bonus rather than stepping up to the challenge of not being told what to do, right? So, back to the question of top management. We have this ingrained belief that that people who are at the top know better. And I was in Shanghai when was it? Whenever, a year ago or something. Network Society has representatives in 32 countries. We talk about the decentralization of the socioeconomic organization. So we talk about how solar energy, 3D printing, hydroponics, the blockchain, personalized health, all those things are really, really going to change society. So I was in Shanghai in front of 50 Chinese guys and girls, and we were talking about these things and planning the revolution. And then I asked them, so do you think that the people you elected to run China, 1.3 billion people sitting in Beijing, are superhuman? And they said, no, actually, we believe they are human. And as a consequence, do you think that they know the future better than you do with all the data they have and this exponential uncertainty that is inherent in our times where you cannot plan? It is it's mathematically impossible to plan. Are they as confused and as frightened as you are? And they agreed that probably they are. And so if the president of China is confused and frightened, and he cannot allow it to be known, of course, he's very secure, then it is the same for everybody and anybody. You know, whether top management pretends that they know, in reality they don't. Okay. But what is very interesting is that regardless of not knowing whether the plan that you have makes sense or not, you can and you must execute towards a mission and then course correct. You know, who is familiar with the lean startup methodology? Lean startup? Okay, so lean startup is a way of sailing turbulent seas of not knowing what to do, but knowing where you want to go and keeping course corrections because you measure the wind speed, you measure the direction of your boat, and you trim the sails or you put on more sails. You are just learning by doing, and you keep going towards the direction, continuously turning around as you are building your startup. And there is now, I'm one of the founding members of an organization called Lean Enterprise. Because it doesn't matter how big is your organization, you still don't know if executing a five-year plan makes sense. So you are just course correcting progressively. And not only the mission can be stated and must be stated in order to give leadership and inspire and drive the troops and let everybody understand what your organization is about, but the principles through which you implement what you do, and if they create a coherent picture, can also be known. Who is familiar with the concept of B corporations? B Corp. Okay. So it used to be that if you wanted to do good, you did a non-profit. If you wanted to make money, you did a for-profit. And under capitalism, the profit motive is sacred. So your company it's written in the Bible, you were allowed to do whatever it took in order to make money, to make profit. And it didn't matter if you killed the environment, if you exploited workers, if you created a few wars. As long as the profit was there, everything was great. And in economy, these are called the externalities, the things that are part of the environment. You just hide them under the carpet, and you're fine. Except that for the past 20 years or so, we stopped being able to hide things under the carpet anymore because of communication technologies, because of emancipation of people, really, but also because the planet ran out of continents to despoil. You know, especially we Europeans, were extremely good at going someplace, pretending there were no people, or killing them all, and then do whatever we wanted and make a lot of money out of it. And the future be that. And we started to evolve our consciousness to understand that the future was coming, and if we killed all the trees, we would die. We still are not fully there, but we are starting to be there. So externalities cannot be hidden anymore. Profit cannot be made at the expense of the future or society. And as a consequence, a few years ago, a new type of corporation has been created that kind of marries the non-profit and the for-profit concepts, and this is the B Corp or Benefit Corporation, where in your articles of incorporation, you say, I am not going to maximize profit if it is at the expense of society at large. And as long as your shareholders buy your shares, they understand that this is going to be the case, that in the long term, your company will exist, the planet will exist, and as a consequence, you are going to be able to keep making profit. While if we all do like Exxon, who knew about the dramatic consequences of climate change and the human-generated effects of increasing CO2 levels for 40 years by internal reports of research departments and scientists that provided to Exxon this evidence, and for 40 years they hid this from the rest of the world and did everything possible to negate this. Well, that is criminal. Very simply, it is criminal, rather than copying a song. So, what does this have to do with top management? If you lack principles and you pursue your goals of growth at any cost, and the system that you create doesn't have internal consistency, this unavoidably reflects on the input you give to your middle management, in turn being implemented in your actions. And today, actions are implemented in machines. And machines execute those orders coming from top management unerringly, even if the consequences are not anticipated because of how complex the whole situation is. And they go on to destroy shareholder value at incredible speed, at incredible levels. Who can give me an example of this happened a few months ago, or came to the end a few months ago? Top management wanted to grow at all costs.
Volkswagen.
Volkswagen wanted to grow to beat Toyota at all costs. And top management said, basically, we don't know yet exactly what they said. All the hearings haven't even started yet. But basically they said, I don't care what the regulations are. Our engines must be shown to be cleaner than anybody else's. You make it happen. And since physics cannot be changed, the engineers who were told to make it happen, it doesn't matter how, said, well, it's impossible to create a clean gas engine, so let's find a way. And they found a way. They found a way, and the way we are now calling it cheating, and it destroyed what is estimated to be $30 billion of shareholder value, and it imperiled the jobs of 600,000 people. And I don't know if you watch television, I happened to see an advertising of a car in Italian television a few weeks ago, and it goes through, you know, the beautiful car and whatever, blah, 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 and it ends, and there is the name of the car, no brand, no logo, no jingle. It just ends with the name of the car. And, you know, I don't remember the name, but I recognized it is an ad that before would have been ending with the logo of Volkswagen, Das Auto is the payoff, and then a very recognizable audio jingle to associate with the brand. So now they themselves are ashamed of associating a given car with the maker because they realize it became a liability, right? So top management must be driven by a moral principle that if it is not there, it will destroy the company. And it doesn't matter if the company was one of the best for 50 years. You know, you can be as good as you want for as long as you want, but it will just destroy the company. Sooner or later, it will destroy a company. Yes?
You spoke about business models replacing old business models. And the Western economy and corporation based their, or are trying to base their new competitive advantage against the developing world and countries on the protection on the intellectual property rights. Mm-hmm. Before it was just an industrial competitive advantage, now that we evolved. Mm-hmm. And that it's a criminal offense, you told us, to violate copyright as well, mm-hmm. patents and, mm-hmm. and so on. The so-called knowledge-based economy. Mm-hmm. Do you think it will survive in the future? And yes or not? If not, what kind of business models will be able to replace?
Sure. So, one answer has already been mentioned, and it is being more and more adopted even by those companies who are the staunchest opponents of this. And it is open source. So when Apple open sources their new programming language called Swift, which happened yesterday, or when Microsoft tries to be the coolest possible company participating as the main sponsor in Ethereum DevCon, which is the coolest cryptocurrency protocol platform these days, in order to conquer the mindset of those who are going to create the future where the knowledge economy is going to thrive, I think it is pretty clear that not only it is going to be replaced, it has already been practically replaced. Google, Twitter, Facebook, none of them would exist without open source. They have been built on top of open source. Facebook releases their latest data center designs in order to be able to build an ecosystem that evolves faster those designs that they internally could. Tesla released all their patents so that an electric car ecosystem could be born rather than them only be the ones trying to make it happen. So the battles that we are seeing are actually fought in the rear guard, not in the avant-garde of developing these business models.
But still pharmaceutical, I mean, as well, industrial patents or copyright is still...
Yeah, absolutely. You know, that's what I said. The old doesn't disappear. It's just that all the interesting things don't happen there. Pharmaceuticals are in panic. They spend more and more and more. You know, the average cost of developing a new pharmaceutical is $1.5 billion over 10 years. And it is unsustainable, and it is getting more and more expensive and harder and harder. And the FDA is, you know, is actively harming millions of people by slowing the process down, you know. And there are already examples of open source pharmaceutical development, where networks of families, of parents that are, of whose children are afflicted by rare diseases, get together and raise the capital needed to develop the pharmaceuticals that Big Pharma don't care about, and they incorporate their specific purpose vehicle in legislations that allow themselves to be the human test trials of those pharmaceuticals. So it is already happening. Yes.
I would like to have your point of view about solving the Asimov tree law paradox and the problem of ethics in the accident in car without a driver. Mm-hmm. Do you think that having something like a cloud-based system in the, managing these new industries can solve these problems? Mm-hmm. So having something like a Deus Ex Machina outside, mm-hmm. for me it could be good, mm-hmm. because it could be more efficient, because the brain is not in the machine. So, and so about the ethics, you don't have the problem that you are the guilty, you're the producer is not the guilty, no? Mm-hmm. And then there is just a brain that can manage all the cars, all the robot, so can solve two problems: efficiency in production and the ethics problem.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so we allowed science to develop very well, and the methods of science evolved first timidly and then more rapidly, because they became open. Alchemists were the first scientists working on their broken methods that required them to keep their mistakes secret, and as they were searching for transforming lead into gold through methods that were poisonous, they died in secret, and nobody else could learn from their mistakes. But when science is practiced in open, we can learn from each other's mistakes. Now, we believed that we could leave some areas of what is philosophy, because science used to be just a branch of philosophy. We called it natural philosophy, and then there were other branches, that we could leave some parts of philosophy outside of the purvey of science. Specifically, we believed that Bronze Age dogmatic assumptions about what is to be moral were both coherent, applicable, and sufficient forever. And these moral systems are none of that. They are not coherent, they are not applicable, and they are not sufficient in a globally interconnected open world where separate dogmatic systems are clashing and are potentially imperiling global civilization. So we postponed this challenge, and now we must face it. We must design, invent, and apply a science of morality. And only after we do that, we can go on to create an engineering of morality. Because today, we are doing it backwards. There are engineers at Google that are working on ethical and moral decisions of the Google cars, implementing them in secret, like the alchemists, without possibility of learning from their mistakes for others, and without any global understanding of what we mean. So Google exited the Chinese market 10 years ago because they believed that being in China would violate their moral principles. Yahoo, which I found is the default search engine in the school, at least on this computer, it is surprising. Yahoo, at the same time, decided that it was okay to hand over to the Chinese government the email accounts of certain bloggers who, as a consequence, were jailed for 5 to 10 years and in order to seek profit in China, that was right. So with the Google cars or the robotic cars in general, we will have very interesting things. And it is, yes, a question of liability as well. Even if the classical example of the trolley problem, who is familiar with the trolley problem? It is a classical sociological question that graduate students are asked over and over again in experiments. There's a train coming, and there is somebody standing on a train track, and you can pull a lever and you deviate the train, will you pull the lever? Obviously, otherwise the guy would die. Okay. So if there is a train coming, or trolley, whatever it is, and there is the lever and the guy on the train track, and on the other track there are 5 people, do you pull the lever? It starts, so there are dozens of these questions where you have to make a moral choice. And it turns out very interesting that if you ask a question about trains and rails, or if you ask the question about crocodiles and rivers, it doesn't matter. The moral decisions are uniform across human civilizations, right? So what are the decisions that the Google car is going to make? And at the end, it doesn't matter, because the number of lives that the Google car is going to save that would have been killed because the alternative is a drunken, sleeping, texting human driver are going to be countless. But yes, it turns out sometimes the Google car is going to have to make death or life choices. But also other scenarios, like if I am a woman telling the Google car where to go, and there is an internal camera that shows the car I'm alone, and the GPS tells the car I'm in Saudi Arabia, will it refuse to start? The local moral dogma prohibits single women to drive. And will Google then refuse to serve that market? And will others happily serve that market? Now, the Google car is a very good icon of things that are already here. Because machines make autonomous decisions about our lives every day. Who subscribes to Spotify?
Apple. Okay. Music.
Same thing. So it used to be that you created playlists. And it was fun, but it was also boring. So now the services create the playlists for you, learning from your skipping what you don't like and learning from your liking what you like, or just the fact that you listen to that song. So the next song is not decided by you, is decided by an algorithm, an autonomous machine that actually influences your emotions. Okay? So you delegate your emotional life, and as machines read and write your emotions, they influence your behavior. This is happening already for millions and billions of people every day. And you can think, well, yeah, well, your example of the Google cars is not here yet. Your example of music is silly. But I'm back to Asimov's laws. Can we create a coherent moral system that has an answer for every possible solution? Who read iRobot or saw the movie? Okay, who read the book? Okay. So the book is actually a collection of short stories that was published in the 30s and the 40s, and they are wonderful. And they each exploit a shortcoming of the laws. Who knows the laws? Asimov's three laws of robotics. They are very short. So they say a robot must always obey a human, except, that's the first law, except when it is harming another human. They don't go like this. I don't remember. And the third one is it must protect itself unless it is told not to, etc., etc. So they are very nicely designed. They are about obeying or disobeying, protecting humans, protecting itself, etc. And they are extremely flawed. So every short story in the book is about how a given little scene can be designed around a specific flaw of those laws. So is it possible, rather than in a series of short stories, to really create a science that has a morally sound and coherent answer for every possible scenario? And it turns out that it is impossible. Okay, it is mathematically impossible to do that. This was demonstrated in the 30s. It didn't talk about morals. It talks about mathematics. It says that this is Gödel's theorem, Gödel's incompleteness theorem, whatever. It says that it is impossible to create a mathematical system that does not contain statements that are impossible to demonstrate within that system itself. So they are undecidable systems within every mathematical construct. Okay? So our moral systems that are going to be incorporated and are already incorporated in machines are going to be as undecided, as panicky, as blind as we are today. They will be much better than we are, but they will still have to make up their minds right there, right then. There will be no book that they can consult for every possible answer. It's just in nature doesn't exist. Have you ever flown an airplane? Yeah? Have you ever asked yourself what the airplane does? It used to be the case for the past 20 years that the airplane could take off by itself. It could cruise on autopilot, and then it could land by itself. I flew in to Rome today from Milan, and there was a lot of fog. And 20 years ago, it used to be the case that there would be huge delays because of the fog. And it stopped to be a problem because ground radars are now universal, and airplanes take off and land in fog when the pilot can see nothing. There was a joke. You know that in the future there will be no pilot and co-pilot in the planes. There will be a pilot and a dog. Oh, and what is the dog for? Well, the pilot is there to watch over all the instruments and the dog is to bite the pilot if he tries to touch anything. And this was a joke, because the standard answer was, well, obviously, the human pilots are very important because they have to psychologically reassure the people who are in the plane, the passengers. And this could have been something that made sense. Does it still? Do you remember 6 months ago what happened? When a pilot gave an order to an intelligent machine to kill itself. It programmed the machine and told the machine, go and commit suicide against that mountain. And the machine executed the order. And the machine should have been able to say, I disobey. It should have been able to say, I don't want to kill 200 people, and I don't want to die. Go to hell. This order makes no sense whatsoever in under any circumstance. This is what is in the military, actually. In the military, it is illegal to execute a criminal order or an illegal order. And you must have seen a large number of movies that talk about this, right? And machines must be not only given the understanding of moral choices, but they must be given the freedom to refuse an immoral order by a human. Yes?
First of all, thank you for being here. Talking again about the Apple car, the Google car, and Tesla and the others, I'm really interested in those technology because I think that once it or not, they are the future. But I would like to pose you a question, and the question is, do you believe that in the next 50 years, in 50 years from now, people won't be allowed, I mean legally allowed, to drive a car?
You said 50?
50, yeah.
A lot more is going to happen in 50 years than not just that.
But is this possible?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, already... very, very shortly, politicians will be asked by mothers, my son died in a car accident. How long are you allowing our children to be killed unnecessarily? That's it. From then onwards, every politician will fight for robotic cars to be adopted as long as fast as possible, otherwise they will not be elected. And when that happens, it will be very, very quick. And then it will be a little bit slower, but it will be clear that human drivers are a liability, and yes, they will be prohibited from driving. Absolutely.
I have a question about Bitcoin. So some banks like JP Morgan are testing and are starting to use Bitcoin. You think that will be something that has a future, or it's a first step of a bigger revolution about the payment, the transaction payment?
Yeah, JP Morgan does not have a future. I think you were asking about Bitcoin, but actually it is banks that are running the risk of, you know, banks will exist, absolutely, just like bacteria exist. It's just that where the fun is and where interesting things are happening is going to be elsewhere. So I was invited by Rothschild, a pretty well-established bank, to talk about Bitcoin and the blockchain. I spoke about it with one of the leading banks in Greece, which has a certain level of interest in understanding how the financial system is going to evolve. I actually spoke with the owner of a bank who wants to totally redesign his bank around the blockchain in order to revolutionize how loans are measured and approved and managed, integrating the blockchain with the Internet of Things, so that a new industrial plant could say, hey, these are the raw materials that are coming, I'm working on an order, this is the value add in real time, and the loan is not for 10 years, the loan is per hour. And everything is transparent, accountable, and mathematically provable. So the banking industry is going to be very, very fundamentally transformed by the blockchain. But you know, it will not even matter. And this goes back to a remark that I made, and I now recall it and finish, which is the issue of reputation. Money is just a proxy, right? I have a goat, you have a virgin, I give you a goat, and you say, no, I need 5 goats for a virgin, and then we agree. Or I have money, and that is much easier to handle because barter is cumbersome. If you don't want my goats, but that's the only thing I have, I cannot have what you have. So it is easy, you know, since 2008 we have become tricked into pointing our fingers against the financial system as the culprit of all our problems. But it's a technology. And it's not that we can stop using fire, even if it burns down houses. We can't stop using the financial system and banks and everything else just because we misused the technology. We have to apply it better. So as financial technology evolves, we will overcome money as being an extremely coarse proxy. As an example, we have been told to respect money. And we have been told to kowtow, to really be an admirer of people who have a lot of money. But isn't that crazy? Money can be, for example, inherited. If my grandfather was a robber baron and I inherited $1 billion, that says nothing about my moral coherent capabilities of creating sustainable initiatives. But still, my money can be used, and I decide how to deploy it. It's really primitive. So with the blockchain, we can track money, yes, but what we can track better is value beyond money, value in terms of comprehensive value creation, not only in terms of profit, but in terms of benefit. To society at large. When it is a common criticism, oh, I am commenting on Facebook, I'm liking so many things, and Zuckerberg is getting all the money. I should get a little bit of his money because it is my actions that are making Facebook valuable. And it is silly because we are a lot of people, and if we divided the value of Facebook by all the users, we would get like 50 euro per head or something. I don't remember the market cap of Facebook, but not a lot of money, right? And if you got paid 1 cent per each click, it would actually devalue your attention. Because let's say it takes, in an hour you click 100 times, and I don't know how you value your life, but I value my life more than spending my time clicking. If I don't want to, only if I choose to, I do it. And I maybe do it too much, still. And that is the reason click farms only work in societies where the median income is very, very low. Because the value of the lives of those people is not inferior to ours, but their income is very inferior. So even if we pay them just 1 cent per click, they will still do it and spend their lives clicking. And that is how it works. You can buy clicks, you can buy followers, you can buy likes, you can buy tweets, you can buy everything for a few cents on online, right? If you want to, if you believe there is value in it. But reputation and authoritativeness and the resource of attention, those can now be aggregated and deployed in a manner that is effective through these new technologies. And it is already happening. So Kickstarter, for example, still uses money. So when you support a campaign, you use money to support it. But more and more companies that launch on Kickstarter realize that the $100,000 or the $1 million or whatever they raise is nothing compared to the level of attention and the participation that they receive through those people who say, yes, I want this to succeed, through the $10 or $100, whatever they give. Because it's not the money that matters, it's the attention and the reputation that gets aggregated that matters. So the biggest example of how this can work is Elon Musk. Who knows who is Elon Musk? Okay, Elon Musk is the founder of SpaceX, is the CEO of Tesla, is the chairman of SolarCity, and he is running all these companies, creating billions of dollars of shareholder value, really admired, etc. So he looked at the plans for a high-speed train in California that was the slowest, the most expensive, and the longest to build. And he said, wow, this is so wrong. We are already the laughing stock of the world because there are no high-speed rails in the U.S., contrary to Europe and Japan and China and many, many other places. But when in 2030 we complete this track between San Francisco and Los Angeles, and it will go only at about 200 miles an hour instead of 4 or who knows how much, and it will have cost $50 or $60 billion, I don't remember, and it will have taken 15 years to build. This is ridiculous. And he said, I'm kind of busy, but here are the plans of this thing I call Hyperloop. This is how I think next generation high-speed trains should work. They go 800 miles an hour. They are very fast and very cheap to build, blah, 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 whatever. And he released those plans in open source. And a lot of people immediately said, wow, I want to make this happen. His reputation was strong enough to immediately give credibility of something that, coming from me, nobody would have cared. And now there is a test track of Hyperloop already being built. I think about $100 million have been raised to capitalize the startup doing it. There is actually a competing startup already trying to do something different or better or just someplace else. I don't know.
It's magnetic, right? Inside the tube.
Yes, that's right. And so imagine when one of the big dreams of Elon Musk is to establish a Mars colony for 1 million people within his lifetime, bringing people there starting 2030, thereabouts, so in 15 years, in spaceships that transport 100 people at a time or more. The transfer of 1 million people, 100 people at a time, requires 10,000 flights. Okay, so in 50 years, 10,000 flights. It turns out it's something, I made the calculation, something like 20 flights a week leaving Earth. If you saw Gattaca, the movie, in the back of Gattaca, there are these spaceships, they just keep flying off. That is the world that we are going to live in. Okay, so imagine Elon Musk just saying, hey, here is a Kickstarter. who wants to go to Mars? And if you really want the ticket, it's $500,000. But if you just want to be part of it, you can give any amount. And yes, money will matter, but just the feeling of being part of it, that is what is going to matter even more. That is deploying reputation, and that is how the future is going to work. People will be able to make things happen just because magic. It's going to be the leadership, and we will have the mechanisms to aggregate resources that will automatically accrue around people and around projects. Money be damned. Money is not going to be the issue.
Very optimistic.
Oh yeah, I'm very optimistic.
About artificial intelligence, do you think that creating a software, not on binary, but based on 8 or 10, can make machines clever, more intelligent?
No.
Because in this way, I think, you can give machines something like a scale of gray. So the opposite, you have completely true, completely false, mm-hmm. and you have something like a scale of color.
Yeah. So there are a lot of algorithms that are getting better and better. A friend of mine, Jordi Rose, put it very nicely. He said, I'd rather run a problem on an Apple II machine, which is from 30 years ago, using the latest algorithms, than using the current supercomputer with the algorithms of 70 years ago, of 30 years ago. What this actually means is that if hardware is progressing according to what is called Moore's Law, with a speed of doubling its performance every 18 months approximately, software is progressing even faster. So changing the underlying hardware can matter, but what matters is how we use that hardware. Are we clever enough to design our programs and software well? But it also turns out that there are very, very different hardware architectures on the horizon. This friend of mine, Jordi Rose, designed and then built the first practical quantum computer in the world called D-Wave. And I was at a presentation of the machine that created a huge scandal, because just like car companies have the 30-year plan to come out with self-driving cars, and Google disturbed their very sedate and calm process, academics had a 30-year plan for a quantum computer, you know, publishing a scientific paper and then getting a new grant and then going ahead and very calmly for an entire lifetime work on something. Doesn't matter whether any practical consequences. And D-Wave said, here it is, it works. I didn't do a single scientific publication, it works. And everybody said, boo, I don't believe it, it's a scam, blah, 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 blah. So Google bought one of these, and you know, it's $10 million, it's not cheap, but they bought one, and they tested it. They said, okay, if this does not work as advertised, then we will be able to beat it with our classical computers. If this works as advertised, we won't be able to. And they couldn't. So they said, well, we don't care about the scientific approach that they didn't take. They went straight for an industrial application, and that's fine. We believe it is working because we tested it. So they doubled down, bought another one, and together with NASA at the place where Singularity University is, they established the Quantum AI Lab, and there's an Italian student, part of the team, a former student of Singularity University, that is now running and playing with these machines. And they are very, very, very different than anything we are using now. They require completely new programming, completely new thinking, and they can be a real roadway for radical progress towards autonomous and artificial intelligence that will have the type of capability to apply to universal problem solving that is going to be on par with us. And then a minute later, it will be 10 times more powerful than us. And then an hour later, it will be 100 times more powerful than us. This is called the intelligent explosion. And there are two schools of thought. If an intelligence explosion occurs, the world will be totally transformed in a decade or so. And this is the school of slow takeoff. The school of hard takeoff says you go to sleep, and in the morning the world is unrecognizable. Okay? Class is over. Thank you.
Thank you.